welcome back. I made a whole bunch of these grinding wheel adapters that fit my surface grinder and my tool cutter grinder, and I will show you how I made them. I already made two of these adapter flanges quite some time ago, and they were just fine. There was only one problem. My single cutter grinder runs counterclockwise, and my surface grinder runs clockwise. So on the tool cutter grinder, the nut tightens itself under load. On the surface grinder, the nut loosens itself under load. So I had to come up with a solution, and I didn't want to make separate flanges for the surface grinder with left-hand thread. I want to be able to swap them back and forth. So what I came up with is a washer that's keyed to the wheel adapter and does not transfer the torque from the wheel to the nut. It stops at the key down here. So that's what we're going to make. So hang around. Okay, I'm cutting the material for the washers that hold the wheel in place to thickness, and I'm using my chuck backstop so I get nice and parallel faces. I could also just rough them down and grind them on the surface grinder's thickness, but this is faster and way good enough. I get thickness tolerance of about 1/100 of a millimeter all over. So that's perfectly fine. I mean, I'm trying out a new to me Kurocera insert that works surprisingly well on my small lathe. I can take quite a heavy cut with this, even if it's a finishing insert. But even finishing is still, that what the industry calls finishing, is still a roughing cut for my toy lathe. So just machining it down. So we got all the wheel adapters and the washers roughed out, and we made a horrible mess. The Fogbuster did a quite good job on the lathe. I really like this thing. It's very reliable so far. And the Kurocera insert I was using is still good, and I'm surprised about the performance this insert gives me on this small lathe. I took a depth of cut of 2 millimeters. I was hand feeding, but as you can see by the chips, they turned into a nice straw color. Some of them turned blue. So I was running a pretty good feed and a reasonable surface speed or cutting speed. So I will do some more tests with these inserts, but so far I like them for my little toy lathe. So let's get this mess cleaned up. Okay, I roughed all the wheel adapters out to this state, and right now I'm turning the finished diameter on this portion. I'm doing a facing cut. I do the thread relief and the big chamfer for the thread. I try to batch them out because I don't have a DRO on my machine. I have to find other ways to work fast and efficient, and by doing multiple steps at once on all pieces instead of doing all steps on one piece and then proceeding on to the next part, this is way faster. So let's go back to the machine. Now I have a lathe tool for thread relief. Now I take a gauge block with the right dimension. Don't do this with your laboratory grade Mitutoyo class 0 gauge blocks. Use old worn out gauge blocks if you have to touch off with a cutter. They are still plenty good enough for this task. Okay, set up to drill the screw hole into the wheel adapters for the check thread. So there will be an M8 thread so you can pull the wheel adapter off the taper of the grinder. And right now I'm drilling the 6.8mm tap hole size all the way through. There we go. One drawback to Mr. systems like the Fogbuster or also the Noga, they are damn loud. It's really noisy, especially when you aim it at a hole. That's a good idea in that case. The rack and pinion tail stuck on my lathe has a dead stop. I moved the tool up against the work. I clamp the tool, the quill, and then I can move the stop freely along the quill. And I'm using a 7mm gauge block against this face to set up the stop. And now I can do 7mm deep counterbores perfectly fine. For counterboring, I'm using cutting oil, not the Fogbuster. The Fogbuster can't deliver that much lubricant that's needed for a counterbore. Or it can, but I have to crank up the liquid screw to a very high degree, and then it's messy. I don't like that, so I'm using some cutting oil out of a bottle. There we go, number one done, first one done, on to the second one, and that's again the nice thing about the chuck backstop. I just butt the part up against the stop, I have the stop on the quill of my tailstock, I'm ready to go for the next one. Two done, five to go. I'm just chamfering the edges of the counterbore slightly. That's also just batch work. You see, the key never leaves my hand. because it's just faster that way. But I can still produce a good result, even if I try to work somewhat fast. Okay, we're on the workbench. Quick brainstorming. These are the wheel adapters as we roughed them out. Counterbore, chamfer, turn diameter, thread relief. Next step is to put a relief in here, from here. I want to machine back all this blued area, just a bit more even. About 0.5 millimeters deep, so we leave a rim on the outside here that's about 5 millimeters wide. And for that we need to grind a custom tool, a face parting tool or a face grooving tool. And I have a piece of high-speed steel, 8x8mm, the good Momax cobalt tool steel here. And we're going to grind this into the right shape. What we want is something like a parting tool, but on an angle so we can come in from the side. We will, I think this side is better. We will come in from the side, then we will pull out and create the relief, and then we can move the tool clear, change a part, and proceed on. For that, let's see, we wanted to set it up at something like this angle. We need some relief here. We need some relief here, and we need some relief here. So basically, we're creating a parting tool that's that has about a 45 degree angle on the front end. Let's go to a bench grinder and talk this out. Okay, that's your typical bench grinder, rough wheel, coarse wheel, aluminum oxide. As we have high-speed steel with a high cobalt content, I'm not worried about drawing out the temper of the steel. You can grind this stuff until it's glowing, then you let it cool back down to room temperature and it's still hard as it's before, even a bit harder. It jumps slightly up in hardness when you heat it above a certain temperature. And note that I'm only grinding on the outer diameter of the wheel. I'm not really grinding on the sides of the wheel for most purposes. Now I'm grinding the 45 degree face on the front, with quite a bit of clearance because we're face plunging with the tool. Now we go to the fine wheel and give it a light touch up. Now I'm doing something that you shouldn't do because you will ruin your diamond wheel, blah blah blah. I don't care because this is a 10 buck diamond wheel and I do it all the time. So. I'm giving the edges a very fine finish on the diamond wheel and put a very fine radius on the edges. Okay, we're face plunging with the tool. I did already 4 of them and I had to change the grind slightly, but nothing major. Thank you. Here I'm doing the same relieving on the washers, with the only difference that I can go out from the center because we have bore. There we go. Another operation. And as I said before, I truly enjoy the lathe backstop. I wish I made this thing 10 years ago. I have always a perfect registered part in the chuck without many effort, and it's very precise. Okay, now we're boring the washers to 20.02 millimeters internal diameter. I have it already dialed in. I set up a high-speed steel boring bar. And I do this in, I pre-drill them to 18 millimeters, and I do this in three cuts. I take 1.5 millimeters in diameter, then 0.1 as a measuring cut, and then finishing cut to 20.02. Checking our dimensions. Exactly 0.1 millimeters to go. Taking a scraper. Putting a nice 45 degree chamfer on the edge here without the tool change. Check our dimensions. 20.01. So we are 1/100 of a millimeter off. That's perfectly fine. It's just the washer. When you use a scraper to chamfer internal bores on a lathe, you have to be careful. My triangular scraper for the lathe is just an old file that I re-hardened. I hardened it and I didn't temper it, so it's glass hard. And I ground it like a three-sided scraper, and that's what I use. And I honed the edges. This thing is pretty much very sharp. And when you use it, you rest your hands on the bed of the lathe, just like this. And you bring not the cutting edge into contact with the work. Then you will get a catch. Then you get a catch, you chatter, and the scraper goes all around and bore. That's bad. You bring the face, the whole surface of the scraper in contact with the work. It won't cut that way, and then you slightly tip it over so the leading cutting edge gets into contact with the work. And be sure to do this at low RPM, otherwise you will also get chatter like hell. Okay, now I'm in contact and I'm not taking cut. Now I'm tipping it slightly into the cut and we're shaving off a nice chip. Okay, back to work. Okay, I'm set up to thread the M20 by 1 fine thread for the nut. I ground the tool bit, 60 degree included angle, metric thread of course. This is a metric lathe. I don't have a threading dial, but when you have a metric lathe, and you're cutting a thread that's an even division of your lead screw pitch. The lead screw on my lathe has 2 millimeter pitch, and the thread I'm cutting is 1 millimeter, so that's even division. That means I can open and close the half nuts in every position that I want, and I will always pick up my thread. So let's go. I'm feeding in on the top slide, and I'm retracting on the cross slide. Okay, and there you have it, a pretty much perfect 20 by 1 metric fine thread. I checked it on the toolmaker's microscope, and I will show you a photo through the lens of the microscope in the upper right corner. As you can see, the thread profile looks pretty good. I have a nice radius at the bottom of the thread, and the thread profile itself is formed out pretty good. So I think that's not too bad for a freehand ground tool. This is one of the stock wheel adapters that came with my tool and cutter grinder. And it has a right hand thread to lock the wheel on this adapter. That's perfectly fine because the spindle on the tool and cutter grinder runs counterclockwise. That means if you put strain on the wheel, it tends to tighten up the nut. I'm using the same wheels on my surface grinder, and there the wheel runs clockwise. That means it spins this way, and when you put load or strain on your wheel, it will unscrew the nut, and that's very unpleasant. I had that happen to me, and you turn off that machine quite fast when this wheel starts to bounce around inside the cover. Can't go off because the nut is still on, but it rattles around like crazy. I don't want to have two different styles of arbors, so what I decided to do is, you have this big washer. The washer, how do I explain this? When the wheel moves relative to the arbor, it tends to spin the washer, and the washer drags the nut with it. That way it can loosen or tighten by putting strain on it. I will put a key here in here. I will cut a small keyway on the shaper, and I will silver braze or silver solder in a small piece of square stock, steel stock, and I will machine a key slot into the hub, so the washer is locked against rotation on the wheel adapter. That way, if you put strain on the wheel, the nut cannot loosen or tighten because the washer is not going to rotate. That's my solution. So, okay, that's the setup to cut the keyway into the wheel flanges. And I clamped the part by this big diameter just in the vise and let the smaller diameter drop down on the jaw. So it's registered in this direction in the height. And on the other side, I have a simple work stop cobbled together from stuff I had. This is one of my setup blocks. It's clamped to the table and I have a strap clamp resting against the workpiece. So I just drop the part in on the vise jaw and then roll it over against this clamp as a stop, and I'm always perfectly registered. This is way precise enough for this application. And I'm running a three flute carbide mill, 4mm in diameter at full depth, single pass in, and then I take a cleanup pass 1/10 of a millimeter all around. So I make this slot about 4.2 millimeters wide. I want this to be a loose fit on the key in the washer later. Otherwise, this might get a nightmare to assemble each time.